Welcome back to the Talos Principle, where I haven't actually been paying attention to the last several puzzles because I was having a, you know, an educated adult conversation that you were, I guess, geographically proximate to. But I suppose we're now back here and there are more puzzles for us to solve, so why don't you...
And similarly, I have no idea what type of grown-up conversations were had in the last episode, so maybe we can educate each other.
Yes, why don't you just kind of run along and solve some puzzles now, though, and I'll be here to help. What was this one called? I totally forgot to look at the title.
I never look at the title.
You That's should look at the title. The titles are helpful.
Crisscross Conundrum.
Oh, it's another laser puzzle. Cool. Yeah, these get increasingly insane.
So we've got blue and red. Yeah, that was really cool. You're a buddy who came on to talk about robots with us in the last episode. How did you meet him?
School. We went to...
Oh, cool.
Not college together, but sufficiently close that we knew each other through other friends. And yeah. So these crisscross puzzles. Oh, hey, look, a pile of bricks. That's not remotely suspicious and probably won't come into play in solving the puzzle.
Exactly.
I mean, to be fair, the game is pretty good about not throwing in red herrings. Every once in a while it will. Like a laser receptor that it turns out you actually just have to jam through or something like that, but...
Yep.
But these get completely... By these, I mean the laser crisscross puzzle type things. In the Road to Gehenna DLC, there is, of course there is, another secret area.
Not high enough.
Anyway.
And what about this secret area?
Oh, it has the most fucking insane crisscross puzzles I've ever seen. Like, they're impossible. I don't know. Oh my god, it's...
So how would you characterize the DLC then? Is it just like takes the puzzle solving to the next level?
Yeah, that's the big thing that it does is basically the puzzles in the DLC are going to start in difficulty where the main game leaves off.
Oh, you know what's fun about this? Oh, I can do this. Ugh, I really screwed this one up big time.
Well, okay, so there's multiple gates through there that,
Oh, I made it. Thank you.
Yeah. Okay. So there's multiple gates. You're trying to... Maybe you don't want to get straight to the piece.
Yeah, that's a good point.
You also may want to reset some of these objections. Alright. I mean, that worked. Go for it. But, yeah. I mean, it's
I wonder
great.
If you could solve a puzzle by connecting everything to everything.
Well, assuming that none of the lines cross, sure, why not?
Why you would want to do that, I don't know.
But in fact, now that you have retrieved all the connectors, this puzzle, if I remember, actually becomes relatively simple to solve.
Certainly seems like it.
So, yeah, hopefully we'll get to those if our stamina for puzzles in Alpine doesn't give out. But, holy shit, the super bonus puzzles in Road to Gehenna are fucking insane.
Really? Do they just combine a lot of things that we know already?
No, actually, they don't. It's not particularly through combinations of stuff or, like, gimmicky anything. It's mostly just like they set up a puzzle like this, but make it harder. A much more difficult set of things to wrap around and gates to hold open at the same time, and I suppose I have to give him credit for it being very elegant design, but oh my god, it breaks my brain.
Huh, this is not working out for me.
I think you left another connector inside.
Oh, I'm sure that I did. Oh, yeah. I guess I could just do something fancy with the... Oh, I could just go behind this thing.
Exactly.
Oh, that's silly. I should just connect everything, though, because that's...
Yeah.
Ah, okay. I understand. I am so smart. S-M-R-T.
Yeah, you keep using that little refrain.
I know.
I think you... Well, maybe you can't make that. I don't know. Maybe you... Well, you, remember, there's still one more controller inside that first door. Connector inside the first door. So yeah, after the whole conversation about AI, I actually purely coincidentally got linked to some other thing.
Oh, I didn't need to do that.
Exactly. Oh. Like, there is a whole other connector that you hadn't picked up. Have you heard of the blog Wait But Why?
I have. Why have I heard of that? It sounds very familiar.
So the funny thing is I encountered this blog, in a completely unrelated context. Someone was talking about how the author is great. He likes to, you know, dig in and really explore some deep questions and problems from a very nerdy perspective. But, and, you know, the point that author was making is, but he has this disdain for politics that, well, you know, very nerdy in that you see a lot of nerds doing it is, like, kind of self-destructive because politics matter, yo. But the funny thing was the examples of the good articles are like this big thing he wrote on AI. I don't want to just sit here and describe an article. I'll probably link it in the thread or something like that. But the article that Wait But Why had written on AI, basically what he did is he read a ton of stuff from a bunch of futurists. And if there's anything I would complain about, it's that his sources are people like Ray Kurzweil. I may be pronouncing his name wrong, but he's like a major inventor and engineer at Google and stuff. And the author of the Wait But Why post is like, so, you know, we can take his opinion relatively seriously. Like, he has real credentials about knowing what he's talking about. But having just come off the convert, and so then we get into Kurzweil's crazy predictions. Well, maybe not so crazy, of like how we're going to probably see true AI by 2045 or something within our expected lifespans. But all I kept thinking is like, but like, how many of these people who are talking about it are actually working with a specific problem? Because that was what I appreciate about Kevin's input, is he's someone who's specifically tried to design AI. And, you know, it's really, 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 really difficult. You might have better luck, by the way, if you set that one of your blue connector up somewhere halfway between, because you got to get that angle. But man, this is a tricky thing. I'm not paying enough attention. Anyway, as I understood it, the arguments that Kurzweil and other like futurists who expect to see true AI, you know, within the next couple decades, is basically they're looking at the rate of accelerating technology. The argument seems to go like, the world today is as fundamentally different as from the world of 20 years ago as the world of 20 years ago was from the world of 100 years before that. Ooh, wait.
I just got too many things connected to each other.
Yeah, I was going to say, is that the critical connection that's running? Oh, it is. Yeah, never mind. And so they look at that like, things have changed so much and they keep changing faster. And technology keeps accelerating and accelerating, and the rate at which technology accelerates is itself accelerating. I don't know. Like, I get that people who legit know more about this subject than I do genuinely believe that this is a meaningful observation, but the thing that they're referencing is Moore's Law. Are you familiar with this?
No. How's Moore's Law going?
Okay. Moore's Law is, and in a moment I'll pick up Wikipedia so I can get you the actual, like, dates and names and stuff for it. Ooh, good idea. I think you just cracked it.
Do you think so?
Yeah, I do.
I don't think so.
No? Maybe not. Anyway, it's basically he made an observation about data storage capacity. Or was it processing speed? I think it was... Shit, hang on. Before I embarrass myself, I'm just going to look it up real fast.
You embarrass yourself?
Uh-huh.
I'm the one embarrassing myself here.
Circuit density. So, like, how many transistors? So it is basically data processing capacity. Like, how fast can a processor run? How many transistors can you pack in there? And his observation was, like, that capacity for data processing doubles every 2 years. And based on that observation, this is back in, like, the 1960s or so, when, you know, processors were still the size of houses, more or less. Exaggeration.
Right.
But what's cool is that it's been a pretty accurate prediction.
If the answer does not come to you, do not despair. The worlds of my garden are many.
Ooh, if you leave the puzzle now, you'll get an achievement.
Well, who wouldn't do that? Know your limits. Aw.
Anyway, now you can go back in and finish a puzzle. You actually earlier, like in one of the first couple of videos, got the achievement for Elohim telling you, you know, you can take a break and then just kind of bullying through till you found the solution. I think it's 12 minutes. No, it must be closer to 10 in a puzzle before he says that. Anyway, yeah, so Moore's laws turned out to be not, you know, exactly precise, but really surprisingly accurate in terms of the development of processor technology. Can you loop the blue around behind the red pillar?
Maybe.
I mean, I'm just looking at the layout, and there seems to be kind of little more space or clearer angles there than there are going the way you tried it before. And I feel like that has to be the right idea, and it's just a question of execution. Maybe. So then you can have one connector getting red to the door, and then blue weaving its way around red. No, you have to go around...
I'm out of connectors.
No, you have to lead the blue behind the red pillar. Not behind itself.
Yeah. That's tricky.
No, it's not. Look, you can get...
Oh, it doesn't need to go behind itself.
Yeah, right. Exactly. And look, you can even see it. You can, like, I think you can... Can you get a connection there? Because it sticks out a little bit.
No.
Oh, no, not quite. But still, like, if you put that a little ways... A little bit close to it. Yeah, like walk a little forward maybe. Cool. And now you can probably weave a second one around behind the red pillar. And maybe that'll be enough? And maybe it turns out that my... Oh, yeah. Yeah, you can do this. Nope. That's a red connector.
Oh.
So just drop it, clear the connections. Just connect it to that second one and leave it. No,
but now I'm one short.
Don't do that.
What am I missing?
What the puzzle is. Just connect it to that one you set up there and drop it.
Okay,
now open the door with a single connector from red to red. Move it like out of the path that you're gonna need to take.
And now how do I get the blue one?
You have one more connector.
Where?
Inside that next door.
So the fucking pile of rocks is a red herring.
Yup.
God damn it. You just gave me that whole fucking speech about how this game never uses red herrings and the pile of rocks is essential to the solution. Ah, fuck you. Fuck that. This should have been so easy. I hate everyone.
Hey, but you got an achievement. I helped you get an achievement.
God damn it. Well, that was the easy one. Let's go get the hard one.
Sorry, like I said, I don't remember most of the specific puzzles. I will never intentionally mislead you. Well, that's not true. I didn't mean to intentionally mislead you, at least.
In that one instance.
Oh, boy,
all right,
mine.
It's called Egyptian Arcade.
Anyway, so Moore's Law. Processing capacity has, in fact, pretty reliably doubled every 2 years. And, you know, that's an exponential function, so it keeps getting bigger and bigger and bigger and bigger. And the idea seems to be that they're sort of looking at the much more nebulous and difficult / impossible to measure rate of technological advancement of society and saying, well, that's advancing really fast and exponentially too. And like, yeah, you know, from an anecdotal perspective, we certainly, sure, I'll buy that.
Fine.
Like, yeah.
Look what I just did. Guys? 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 God damn it.
I wasn't expecting the one on the right to get you first. That was surprising. Anyway, like, I will absolutely accept that, yep, you know, the past 30 years have seen more change than the prior 100. You know, I like nice kind of big estimates like that. That's cool. But, like, there are not just... The problem of AI is not just throwing more processing at it. Wow. That was fucking incredible.
You are right.
Like, there's deep systemic problems, and we still have to figure out not just, like, how to make a computer run faster, but, like, what to tell it to do. Like, we don't know all this yet. Like, Ken was talking about one of his major projects that he got an award for was training a robot to recognize itself in a mirror. Like, there is all sorts of really, really difficult, like, basic questions. And I think it's glib to just say, oh, but the more, you know, we have more processing power and technology advances, so everything will ultimately be fine. No, you want to jam the other one. Oh, shit, you placed that very poorly. Well, no, actually, I take it back. If you jam the...
That's fine.
All right, you made it. Cool.
Yeah, so has this ever happened in human history, not with technology, but just, like, the doubling of information at an exponential rate? Have we had, like, for example, art or philosophy? Like, have there been periods of time where society or the world just focuses on a problem, and every year or 5 years or whatever, they just literally double their knowledge until they get to some maximum amount? Can it be applied to things other than AI?
I don't think so. Yeah, you can't get around to that guy inside here.
That's probably not good. Actually, that's probably fine. Oh, nope, not good. Why did that cause him to unfreeze? I thought I froze him. Oh, I froze the door.
Yep, you double jammed. Wait, how does that make any sense at all? Oh, because when you... No.
One was on the wrong side of the door.
Right, so when you unjammed the door, then that turned off the other jammer and reactivated the mine.
All right, time for round two.
So the answer, I think, is I'm not exactly sure what you're envisioning when you describe this, but I think a safe answer is no.
Interesting.
We really are not aware of any period in human history that has seen anywhere near the astonishingly rapid... No, that's a bad plan. Oh my gosh. I wasn't expecting you to have time to make it out there. Good for you.
Oh, me neither. I'm very impressed.
So yeah, you want to think this one through. These two jammers are what you have, so...
Oh, if they hit each other, do they blow up? That'd be cool.
No, sadly.
Oh, goddammit. Is the game over?
Yes. So. Yeah, sorry.
All right, I'll think this through more.
Yeah, I'm fairly sure that there has not been a period in human history that's seen the rate of progress and advancement that you know, the 20th and 21st centuries have.
Do you think that's just because it's like a, what's that hierarchy of needs called, where it's like for so long in human history
Maslow's
Maslow's we weren't even hierarchy. Able to worry about these problems, because...
Yeah, I expect that's probably part of it. I mean, one of the things that's kind of cool to think about is that the attitude towards development and progress and inquiry was fundamentally different for a huge portion of human history compared to what it is today. Like, let me ask you a question, and this is probably a really obvious question. Do things generally get better over time? Do we, as a species, learn more and know more things about how the world works as time goes on?
Sure.
Cool. That's pretty obvious, right?
I agree.
It is obvious. It has been an obvious answer only for maybe 300-400 years. Ever.
Huh. And why do you say that?
Because the idea of progress as being the way the world works really comes from the invention, and I use that word very carefully, of science. Let's jump back to the ancient Greeks a bit. You remember that deeply morbid thing I was telling you about, like, their view of the afterlife, which is basically it sucks.
As long as the body's embalmed or whatever.
No, that's the Egyptians.
Oh, no, that's Egyptian.
Yeah. Sorry, I'm having, like, I have a mild cold and I'm getting, like, weird chills and sweats right now, and it keeps distracting me. Anyway, so the Greeks, and this is fascinating because, no, that won't blow them up. Minds just bounce off each other.
I wasn't expecting it to. I mean, I was a little bit, but...
Okay, so to the Greeks, this is fascinating because they, like, live in fucking paradise, right? Like, the reason that all the pictures show and images and urns show the Greeks wandering around naked and fighting naked and all that stuff is because you can fucking do that in Greece. That's how nice it is there. Sorry, obviously requires some fine-tuning and I don't want to distract you.
Oh, you're not distracting me. I'm very good at ignoring you.
That's good.
Oh, why is this guy only bouncing back like that?
Because that's the end of his path.
Aw. Well, that is annoying, my friend.
Yep.
Although I think I've actually found a solution? No, I haven't. I found a way to get here, but that's not helpful.
Well, at this point, it comes down to, like, very specifically, where are you placing your jammers?
Oh, that's a good point.
Like, instead of opening the door, like, you want to, you definitely, oh, crap. That wasn't wonderful. So you have to get them both out, right? You need to get to the other end of that hallway, and that means you have to get both of the jammers out to here. So... Oh my gosh, I'm sorry. So yeah, the Greeks had a pretty nasty view of the afterlife, but they also didn't think the world itself was so great. Are you familiar with the Greek origin story of where man comes from?
No, I'm not.
So there's four ages of man, and there's different tellings, and there's literally like 6 or 7 different stories in the mythos about, like, where does man come from? But basically, this is the idea of, like, first there was the Golden Age, and that was great, and everyone lived, and the Earth just gave up its bounty naturally, and no one had to work, and everyone was happy all the time, always. And after that came the Silver Age, and that wasn't quite as good. And then came the Bronze Age, and that's when you have, you know, war and all that sort of stuff starts happening. And now we live in the Iron Age, and everything just sucks, and you have to do agriculture, and man, it's just such a giant pain in the ass. And basically, the world just keeps getting worse over time.
Can I grab this?
I'm trying to remember how this sequencing works, and I don't think you can safely grab that unless you've jammed it through some other jammer also.
Oh, it pulls me. I forgot. It pulls me to the center of the jammer anyways. Fucking hell, man. This puzzle.
So, for all that the Greeks lived in basically literal paradise, they didn't actually think the world was a very nice place. I mean, they thought that the guy in charge of the world was Zeus. Right? Zeus is a giant, lecherous, selfish, capricious asshole. He's terrible. You do not want Zeus as, like, a person you know, much less as the guy who's literally in charge of the entire universe and the most powerful being in it. But that's what the Greeks thought the universe was like. Their idea is the universe is basically ruled over a giant, horny dickhead. And we kind of have to make do and hope that the gods don't notice us too much and send plague and kill us all. Because, you know, it basically sucks now. And this idea of, like, the world is basically a bad place and things were better in the past and they will never be that good again persisted for a really long time. I mean, think of the, you know, Judeo-Christian idea of the fall narrative, right? People started out perfect, but then we fell and we're never going to get back. That's just, that's who we are now. This is our life. And the way this, and so the way you deal with this back in the Middle Ages when, like, all this technology has been lost and just people forgot so much stuff, is you rely on what you do know, which is hierarchy. Like, God is above everything, right? That's easy enough. Under God comes, you know, Jesus and Mary and all that stuff. Well, okay, Jesus probably fits in as part of God, but, like, you have Mary and you have the saints and all those people, and they're, like, the courtiers at God's court, and under them you've got other things, and, you know, finally you get down to humans, and you have the king, and then you have the nobles, and, you know, there's that's how you know how things work. They literally, in fact, thought of... Why did you do that?
Do I want to trap them both in there?
Huh. Interesting question. I don't know. I generally don't remember the actual steps you have to take to solve this puzzle, and I'm really sorry, because I wish I could give you a hint at this point. Anyway, I'm getting to something with this giant digression about, like, medieval theology and God as king and... Oh my god. Which is that just as truth comes from God, so do rules and instruction and knowledge come from higher up. You do the things you do because you are told to do them by people who are in charge. You plant your field the way that you plant it because that is how you were told. That's how your father taught you. That's how it is done. Because we don't actually understand enough about agriculture to invent something new. When we try things differently, you know, the crops don't grow and everyone starves. And that's bad, so just do it. And part of the reason there was so little progress is because people were in this mode fundamentally aiming at preservation rather than development. There wasn't this idea that you could do things better. All you could do is preserve the information that you did have and try not to lose anything else. And it wasn't until the invention of science where people were like, hey, but hang on, if we think about this logically, we can actually try new things and not just, you know, fuck everything up constantly. And this is like the 1600s, and that's about where you get the idea that progress is a thing. And it's only after that point that you start having people thinking, yeah, you know, the world is getting better as a default state. So that idea that, like, yep, things get better over time, that's a modern invention in a very literal sense.
Hmm. Yeah, this fucker is not... gonna go. He doesn't even path into that room.
I'm focusing too hard and trying not to throw up right now to really help. So,
So I can just figure this the fuck out. Alright. Man, so I've got two jammers at my disposal. I can use a jammer to force these guys to bounce in an interesting way. I don't know how that would help.
I mean, okay, so you... So if you can get yourself inside that first gate with both jammers and the mines outside it, then you're good. I assume you can't hide on the sides from them?
No, then... not in here.
Okay. I'm sorry to be so silent. The longer we go on, the more I feel like actually kind of sick. We may have to call
the... I wonder if this is gonna work.
Okay.
Maybe? This does allow me to get both of them in here.
Yes!
But it doesn't answer the question of how I get past. Now I just move this one out of the way.
Do it one at a time. So trap the second ball in the back.
Okay, I'll do that in a second.
Sure. And then trap yourself in that first corridor with both jammers and a single mine. And with that, you can get that mine out this door behind you. So, like, freeze the mine. Yep. Go around the other side and freeze him. Nope, gotta freeze him from his other side.
Ah, yeah.
No, you also want to pull that. You want to pull that all the way to the back.
This guy as well?
Yeah, because you want to be safely behind him when you release, and then you're going to open the gate. So you actually that. So you probably want to like stay as far back as you can and jam him. Yeah. Okay, so now you open the gate and you pull the jammer fixed on the mine, and hope you're far enough away. You're far enough away, and then you're going to repeat the process with the other guy after that guy gets through the gate, which you want to close behind him. Perfect.
I don't even need to.
Oh, yeah, good call.
Ah! God damn it. Not helpful.
Well, this one, okay, if you time it right, you can just dodge it.
Did I block him like an idiot? No. Aw, man. I'm so good at these puzzles. Check me out. What? There's more? Fuck! What?
Oh, I thought the jammers!
Oh, are you fucking kidding me? Oh my god, this is the worst level ever. I hate both these puzzles. God, we're only gonna solve two puzzles in 1 hour video. Wow.
I'm sorry.
Are we ever gonna get out of Egypt? I feel like I'm not the first to have this plight. Okay. So step one is get this guy back in here.
And then he'll bounce off. Right, exactly.
And then step two is set this up right here.
And you're good. That wasn't okay. So bad.
No. Wasn't great either. But that's okay. Mm-hmm. Grab these guys. So that's not gonna get me where I need to be.
Well
it'll let me get a little bit.
I mean, look for switches or something like that. And for God's sakes, don't walk into a kill zone. Hey, look, a wire.
So can I walk underneath it? I can, right?
I think so. Yeah, that feels right.
God, this is needless. Why even put this here? This puzzle is so simple, but it's just really high risk. It's like a gotcha moment where you just like you think you solved the whole puzzle, you mute those two things and you run in here and then it's like, haha! Gotcha. Uh-huh. Now you get to redo the whole fucking puzzle.
Alright. I know it's a short video, but I need to call it for tonight. I'm really sorry.
It's not a short video. Those are two fucking horrible puzzles.
Well,
I think we're done with this world though, right?
Are we? So that sounds great. Good for us. Is there a more beeping terminal?
Well, we'll find out shortly.
No. Oh,
but
yes,
we can leave it here.
No, there is. It's totally beeping.
Okay.
Ah, crap.
It's me again.
I can't read it because the stream quality crapped out. Well, maybe it'll resolve.
Quick, tell me the word. The word is faith. Pending. Error. Huh. Mm-hmm. Should I say the word?
I am not going to give you any instructions or advice on how to manage these conversations. That is completely on you.
I feel like I should be duplicitous for as long as possible. Like, trying to appease to both of them until I understand a little bit more about both of, about either one.
All right.
That doesn't usually end well, but let's give it a try. Wait, how does it know the difference between sure sincere and sure insincere when all I typed was sure?
I think it's That's mostly the game well. Trying to judge your character rather than anything else.
Okay.
Like, that may affect what options it presents you in future branches.
Thinking. I succeeded by chance. Huh. This is a kind of a hard narrative to follow. For me. Were you having trouble following it, or were you keeping
sense
of it all?
I don't remember. I suspect you may be overthinking it a little bit.
I'm just gonna go with the confused answer.
Okay.
Yeah, this is funny. Wow, so many answers here. I'm gonna ask how this place is related to the human world. That's the most interesting one to me.
Okay.
As if I particularly care.
All right.
And these are all the things I've already read.
Yep.
Yeah, I'm confused. So the person that I'm speaking, there's the library assistant and the support ticket, and then there's Elohim, and Elohim is the voice.
Yep.
And am I to believe that I've ever encountered Elohim in the terminals?
No, I don't think you have.
So then there are two conflicting voices as well in the terminals.
Elohim has spoken to you while you were at a terminal, but he has not spoken to you through a terminal.
Right. And am I remembering correctly, because we were on a brief hiatus here, that there are two conflicting voices in the terminals trying to steer me in different directions?
Well, so there's Milton Library Assistant, who's pretty consistent, but then there's that other person
who's trying to connect
to you through the terminals,
right.
That we don't know what's up with that.
Gotcha. Well, this will be interesting to see how the story unfolds. I feel like we must be getting close to some real information. They're certainly flirting with giving us some actual clues, and, you know, we're almost done with World B and into World C here, so.
Yep.
Sounds good.
All
right. Well, I hope you feel better next time we record.
Yeah, me too. See you then.
Okay, bye.